Good morning, students. I'm Dr. Nishant, and we will be starting with some lectures on general topics. So for today, we have topics related to parasitology. Dr. Mirza talked about the introduction to parasitology in the morning. So I will continue from that point, and we will talk about laboratory diagnosis of parasitic infections in this lecture. So the learning objectives for this lecture, we need to understand the importance of proper communication between the clinician and the diagnostic laboratories. Now, it may sound a little too simple, but then this is a very important aspect if you want to make a correct diagnosis. So this is a very important aspect we should know. Then we will understand the general approach to diagnosis of parasitic infections. So this is the second aspect we will learn today. So to begin with, the diagnosis of parasitic infections is a little different from some other microbes. It is a very challenging process in many cases. It requires a great deal of experience with excellent examination and interpretative skills at the part of parasitologist. The additional issue with the parasitology is that we have very limited automated procedures available. So most of the time it is the individual's experience and expertise which matters when we are trying to diagnose a case of parasitic infection. So what are the skills required to make a diagnosis? Firstly, it's the ability to appreciate the morphological characteristics of various stages of parasitic agents. Now, unlike the other agents like bacteria or viruses, you will find that in case of parasitic infections, you may have multiple stages, and different stages may be presented in different times or at the same time in the same person. So you need to understand the differences between the different stages, because sometimes it may be relevant to the management of the patient. Then we also need to have a good knowledge about the parasite, including its life cycle, its geographical distribution, what is its epidemiology, seasonal variation, mode of transmission, its pathogenesis, clinical presentation, and host strain. Now, why do I need all this information when I am making a laboratory diagnosis? So this is important in parasites particularly, because many times you will find that in life cycle there might be one or more hosts involved. Now, in some places you will not find a particular host which is there. Maybe, for example, there is some host which is not prevalent in India, but it is there in Africa. So if it is a mandatory host requirement for the parasite, you don't expect to see that parasitic infection in the area where that host is missing. So that may be a clue when you are trying to differentiate different parasites. That is how you will find this useful. Similarly, the geographical distribution, as I discussed with life cycle, then again, geographical distribution may affect the distribution of parasites, because this may be due to the climatic variations or differences in the host which are available in that area. Then some parasites will show seasonal variation. For example, malaria is more commonly seen in the post-monsoon seasons because the vector, which is the mosquito, is seen to breed during this part. So that is why you will find more cases of malaria happening in the post-monsoon period. Then we also need to understand the clinical presentation. So once you clinically examine the patient, if you give some inputs about the clinical presentation along with the specimen for the diagnosis, that is very useful for interpreting the findings that we see in the samples. And finally, the host range is also very important. As I said, there are different hosts which are maybe very important. So if in the absence of a specific host, a parasite may not be able to continue its life cycle in a particular geographical location. A very important aspect of laboratory diagnosis is a good communication between the clinicians and the laboratory. Now, this is very important not only for parasites, but also for any other clinical presentation of a patient, because if you provide the information, then that will help a microbiologist, including a parasitologist, to correctly interpret the findings what we are seeing in the specimens. In the absence of that, the interpretation may be different, may be incorrect. So it is very important that you provide the proper clinical details to the microbiology lab when you send the samples. So correct diagnosis and interpretation of any sample you send for to the microbiology lab depends upon the sample, whether it's appropriate or not. So sample has to be appropriate. You have to send the right sample. For example, if you want to send a diagnosis, any specimen for diagnosis of malaria, then it's an EDTA blood sample which is the preferred sample for diagnosing malarial infection. If you are sending something like serum, then obviously that is not going to be a useful specimen for correct diagnosis. the sample has to be in recommended amount. If you are sending very little amount of specimen, that may not be enough to run the test. So that is why amount should be appropriate. Then it should be in a proper container. By proper container, I mean to say that it should be properly labeled, as well as it should be leak proof. Depending upon the specimen, for example, in stool you have different container for blood specimens you send in vacutainers. So you have to choose the right container. The conditions of transport should be optimum. If you are keeping the sample for a long time or sending in it in inappropriate conditions in terms of temperature, then the viability of the parasite or its identification features may be affected. So that can affect the final diagnosis in the microbiology lab, also in parasitology. Also, the specimen must reach the laboratory within the desirable time frame, because this may be very important, particularly if we are wanting the presence of viability of the organism, because sometimes the organism may lose the viability or it may become inactive. And in those cases, for example, in parasitology, if you are looking for a trophozoite, which is many times picked by its motility, so if it is becoming immotile because of the prolonged time between the collection and the time when we see, then it may be missed. So that is why the time frame is very important. You should take note of that also. Also, it is very important to know that knowledge of patient's history along with relevant physical examination and other relevant test results is available to the parasitologist to interpret the findings in right perspective. So as I said, proper communication is highly desirable between the clinicians and the microbiology lab to make a correct diagnosis, and that is true for parasitology as well. In certain situations, the diagnosis becomes more difficult and complex. Now, with parasitological infections, there are some conditions which can affect the diagnosis and the presentation. For example, in immunodeficiency states, in extremes of ages, and in cases where there is a TREFL-associated infection, in those cases the diagnosis may become more complex, because they may lead to atypical clinical presentation. For example, in immunodeficiency states or extremes of ages, the presentation may not be typical. You may see rare opportunistic infections sometimes, for example, something which is not present in a particular geographical location, or something which is zoonotic coming from animals. Also, an imported case which is not normally present in a particular location, if you are seeing it for the first time, you may not be suspecting it and you may miss it. So you need to understand the more common ones, but you also need to understand what are seen in some other countries, because somebody traveling from, for example, Africa to India, if he is coming with some infection which is not seen in India, and you are not suspecting, because you have not taken a correct history and you are not suspecting that parasite, then you may miss that. So that is why it is important to note that these can further complicate the diagnosis in case you are not taking a proper history, because everything can change the findings what we see in the samples. Depending upon the kind of parasitic infection, you may like to send different samples. For example, in some cases you will send blood samples, in others you may send stool samples, other samples could be urine, other body fluids, biopsy materials, and etc., depending upon the site of parasite involvement. When we talk about fecal specimens, this is one of the more common specimens that we receive for parasitological investigations. It is the preferred investigation for intestinal infection. So when any infection caused by parasite in the intestines, usually it's a fecal specimen which is found to be useful for making a diagnosis. It is also a useful specimen when you are talking about parasites living in the biliary, because many times these parasites will pass some eggs which will be ultimately released into the intestine. So they can be detected in the fecal specimens. In case of protozoal infections, you may find trophozoites or cystic forms. So these are the two main stages which are seen in protozoal infections, which Dr. Mirza must have talked about in the morning, the classification. So protozoal infections, you mainly see the trophozoites and cystic forms in the specimen, for example in amebiasis or giardiasis. In case of helminthic infections, you can expect to see either the adult worms, their eggs or ova, and their larvae. So depending upon the worm or helminth, you can see different stages in the stool specimen. For example, you may see eggs in case of ascariasis, hookworm infections, teeniasis, and others. Larvae are most commonly seen in case of infection with Strongyloides turcorealis, a condition known as Strongyloidiasis. And adult worms may be seen in many parasitic infections, including ascariasis. And segments, which are pieces of the body of a worm, they may be seen in case of segmented worms, which are cestodes. Example is tinea. So teniasis is one condition where you can find segments of the worm. So when you are going to examine a fecal specimen for looking for parasites, it can be broadly divided into two main categories. One is a macroscopic or gross examination, and the other is microscopic examination. Whenever you are sending a specimen for parasitological workup, you should send a fresh fecal specimen, that is a recommended specimen, because that is going to give you best results. You should advise the patient, as well as you should avoid giving any barium salts or any antimicrobials or any charcoal tablets, bismuth or other antidiarrheal compounds, because all these things may affect the findings in the stool specimen and can further complicate the diagnosis of the infection. So these are the things you should take care of. Also, it is important to know what are the instructions you will give to the patient, because most of the times patients are going to bring the specimens from their home unless they are inpatients. So when you are talking to patient, advise him to clean, to take the sample in the clean wide mouth screw cap container, preferably with a spoon, because spoon will help you in taking up the sample from the feces which have been passed out. And this has to be a leak proof screw cap container so that the feces are not going to leak out. So it, you need not fill it to the top, you can just fill it maybe 1/3 to 1/4 to maybe half, but then large amount of fecal specimen is not required, a small amount is enough. So maximum is maybe half, that is maximum. So the spoon is a good amount, which is enough for most of the parasitological workups. If you want to send more, then maybe up to half. Another thing to take care of and you should advise to the patient is that they must avoid mixing of urine in the feces, also water. Now what happens if urine mixes? Now urine has a low pH. And in low pH conditions, some of the parasites may lose their motility. This is particularly true in case of trophozoites of protozoa, because they may lose their motility. And for example, if you are talking about amoeba, Entamoeba histolytica, in those cases, if the trophozoites, as the trophozoites don't have any specific shape, and unless they move, you are very likely to miss them in the stool specimen. There are a lot of debris, so it is very difficult to see these parasites unless they are moving. So in the presence of a low pH, this motility may be affected, and obviously then you are going to miss the finding. What about water? Now you should avoid mixing with water, because many times water will have some contaminants which may include some protozoa as well. And these protozoa, if they are present in the water and this mixes with the stool specimen, you may confuse them with some other pathogens. That is why even water mixing should be avoided in stool specimens. The other point to note is, that is true for again all specimens you send for diagnosis purposes, they must be labeled properly. And by labeling means, I mean that patient's name, their unique identification number, date and time of collection, accompanied with a properly filled requisition form. And this is a must we should send to the lab so that they are able to actually correctly interpret the findings. This is a very important thing you should do. Date and time are also very important, because your findings may vary depending upon the duration which has passed between the specimen collection and the examination time. So these all things are very important, so that proper patient management can be done by giving the right information and right specimen. Also, it is recommended that when you are talking about fecal specimens for parasitological investigations, at least 3 fecal specimens should be examined. And these fecal specimens are to be collected on separate days, preferably every alternate day, and all samples must be collected within 10 days. Now this is because many times parasites will not pass the eggs or the larvae every day, and they may not be seen in the stool specimen on each day or each time. So you are trying to increase the sensitivity of your diagnosis, or chances of finding the parasite is increased if you are examining multiple specimens, and by keeping a gap of a day or more, the chances that you will find the eggs are more likely, rather than taking it every day. So all the specimens should be collected within 10 days, and these 3 specimens should be examined, and based on that the finding, the diagnosis can be reported. Now in case you are suspecting intestinal amoebiasis, in those cases up to 6 specimens may be sent, and all the samples must be sent within a 14 days period. So this will improve the sensitivity of diagnosing a case of intestinal amoebiasis. Another important point about the fecal specimen is that examination of the stool specimen has to be performed as soon as possible after the passage of the stool specimen. It's not after the collection, after you receive the sample in the lab, but it is a time of collection from the patient. Once it passes out the sample, from that point till the examination point, the delay should be least. Preferably, it should be examined within 30 minutes because the trophozoites will start losing their motility beyond that time. So that is why many times you will get a negative report even though the patient may have the trophozoites of amoeba present in the stool specimen. So this is an important part to know. In case of delay, in case there is a delay in sending a specimen, then you have to use a suitable fixative. Now by suitable fixative, we have multiple options available. For example, a simple one is formalin. Others are methylate iodine formalin, sodium acetate, acetic acid formalin, polyvinyl alcohol, Shorden's fluid, and the universal fixative. Now what these fixative do is they will basically preserve the specimen and then they can be sent to the lab even if there is some delay in the transport of the sample. You should never incubate or freeze the specimen because that can greatly affect the findings in the specimen. So you should not incubate or freeze the specimen before a microscopic examination has been performed. This point is again to be noted. So you should not send the sample by keeping it in fridge overnight and then sending it in the morning. That is not going to help the patient. So take care of that part as well. So when we examine the fecal specimens, the first part is macroscopic examination or gross examination, where we look at different aspects including the consistency. We see whether the stool is formed or soft or liquid in consistency, because this information will give you important clues about the diagnosis. For example, in case of a liquid specimen which is actually representing something very acute, you are more likely to find trophozoites in such a sample because it's something which is acute and trophozoites are usually the parasites which may present like that. Similarly, in a soft sample, you may find both the trophozoites and cysts. You can find both or either of these. And in case of a formed fecal specimen, cysts may be demonstrated. Helminth sac, coccidian oocysts, or microsporidian spores, you may find them in any specimen. So we have to examine all the specimens for everything, but yes, there are some higher chances that you are going to find trophozoite in liquid, while cysts are more likely to be found in fecal specimens which are formed in consistency. Now, while doing a gross examination, you may also come across some adult worms which may be very small, like around 1 centimeter, or sometimes they may be big enough, for example 9 to 10 centimeters. So you may find these worms in the stool specimen on gross examination. Sometimes you may find the segments of tapeworms. This is again a finding which will help you in making a diagnosis. The other thing we should note is the color of the stool, which may be affected due to the presence of blood or mucus. So this may again be indicative of some parasitic infections where you may see blood passing in the stool. For example, in patients with dysentery, in case of amoebic dysentery, you may notice that the patient is passing some blood and mucus along with the stool specimen. Coming to the microscopic examination. So microscopic examination can be done using direct wet mounts, which includes two things. One is a saline mount, the other one is an iodine mount. We can also perform the same preparation after doing a concentration method on the stool. And lastly, there can be permanent stained smears, which is a recommended method in most of the places, that can again be used for making a diagnosis of the parasitic infection. When you do a microscopic examination, you may be able to demonstrate various parasites and their stages. These include ova, larvae, trophozoites, cysts, and coccidian oocysts, and others. So based on the parasite, you may find different stages, and then you can obviously make a diagnosis again. Also, it is important to know that even if you find one parasite, it doesn't mean that this is the only parasite present in the intestine. Many times you will find more than one parasite as well, because the mode of transmission is usually similar in most of these parasites which are causing intestinal parasitosis, and that is using the fecal-oral route. So if you are acquiring something through fecal-oral route, there is a chance that the food or water you have taken is having access to has been mixed with feces coming from human or animal source. In those cases, single or more parasites may infect you simultaneously. So that is how you should look for more parasites even if you find single. Other significant findings that may be suggestive of a parasitic infection or may help in further diagnosis are some non-parasitic structures, which include the presence of red blood cells, pus cells, macrophages, and charcoat-laden crystals. Now, what are charcoal-laden crystals? As you can see in the image, this is a structure which is a reflectile structure here. And these structures are actually derivatives of eosinophils. So many times you have an eosinophilic reaction to the parasites which are present in intestine, and thereby you will find that charcoal-ridden crystals may be seen in such specimens. This is not a specific finding, but yes, if they are present, you should be more careful in looking for more for the parasites in that specimen. Also, it is important to distinguish the parasites from other artifacts. Many times, basically, stool is a mixture of many things. You will have fecal debris, you will have some plant-derived material and other things. So, many times you will find some structures which will confuse you very closely with parasitic elements. So, you should be able to differentiate that as well. For example, this is a pollen grain, but this is looking quite similar to the egg of Tinea. So, this can create a lot of confusion, especially if you are new to the world of parasites. Similarly, you have, this is a vegetative cell, which is again a plant-derived structure. This may confuse you many times, and actually many of the undergraduates, most of you in fact, will be initially highly confused with this structure, which looks very similar to the egg of Ascaris. So many times you will report it like that, but this is not an egg of Ascaris. In further classes, you will understand how to differentiate them. Now this is a yeast, and sometimes large yeast may confuse you with the cyst of Giardia lamblia. So this is again a structure which may be confusing. And now this is something known as a plant fiber, which is again a derivative of a plant, but then it may confuse you with some larva. So these are some artifacts which may be there, and they can confuse you with the parasites. So be careful while diagnosing such infections. Coming to direct wet mount examination. So this can be prepared by mixing a small amount of stool, preferably containing the blood or mucus part, which is mixed with saline. And the second one is Liguori's iodine. So we have one part which is stool mixed with saline, which we have the other part where stool is mixed with the iodine. So the two things have different purposes. The saline mount is not going to interfere with anything in the stool, so it's most useful when you are trying to look for motility of the trophozoites. While iodine is going to kill the trophozoites, so they are going to lose motility. So trophozoites will be hard to appreciate in case of iodine mounts. So iodine is useful particularly because it gives a contrast. So when you are seeing parasitic structures, iodine will impart some reflectivity and staining to the nuclear components as well as to some other structures present within the cysts. So that is how it will be useful in making a diagnosis again. So these are two different purposes for two different mounts. So all the stool specimens which are prepared for direct wet mount are screened by a microscope, firstly under low power 10x objective, and then examined under high power dry objective, which is 40x. So first you look for the presence of some doubtful structures under screening part, and then whatever you find which is suspicious, you can switch to high power and look for the details to further confirm your suspicion. Next comes the concentration techniques. Now, after these concentration techniques, we again prepare the mounts to look for these structures. So what these concentration techniques achieve is basically they increase the concentration of the parasitic elements in the stool specimen which we are going to examine finally. So they help by demonstrating the parasites even when they are low in numbers. And they basically use the principle of centrifugation and differences in the specific gravity of parasites from the fecal debris. So based on these differences, they are able to help us in increasing the possibility of finding the parasites. These concentration techniques can be broadly classified into sedimentation and flotation techniques. Sedimentation techniques are the more preferred techniques most of the times, but you should understand that there are two different things with a little different principle, with each having some advantages and some disadvantages. So among the sedimentation methods, the most commonly used is formal ether sedimentation technique, also known as formalin ethyl acetate sedimentation concentration method. It is a simple method and it gives good results and is able to concentrate most of the parasites of significance for humans. Here we basically use a combination of formalin and ether. Formalin helps to fix and preserve the specimen, while ether is going to adsorb the fecal debris and other fatty materials, so it is going to help in cleaning the final preparation. So what we do here is we mix the stool sample with formalin, and with some subsequent steps we mix it with ether as well. There are multiple steps involved, including mixing of formalin, mixing of ether, centrifugation and filtration. So multiple steps of this are involved, and finally you get four layers in the tube, and these four layers basically comprise of ether, which is the lightest at the top with the dissolved debris. Below this is the fecal debris. Then we have the formalin layer here, and lastly we have the sediment, which is primarily containing some fecal debris along with the parasitic elements, which you may be able to see. So we will prepare a mound from this part. So we prepare a mount, prepare the saline and iodine mounts, and then we can look for the parasite. Now saline is not going to be helpful here in terms of looking for trophozoites, because trophozoites will be killed by formalin. But you can look for other structures, particularly helminthic eggs and cysts, when you concentrate by this method. The other way to concentrate is flotation method. For example, saturated salt solution. Here, again, most of the parasites will be concentrated, but it may miss some of the eggs, particularly eggs of unfertilized egg of Ascaris lumbricoides and eggs of trematodes. Now, these eggs being of higher density than the saturated salt solution, they are going to sink and they are not going to float. So here, because of higher density, the parasitic elements had sedimented, they have settled in the bottom because of the higher specific gravity as compared to the dissolving solution. But here, because the saturated salt solution has a higher specific gravity than the parasitic elements, these parasitic elements float on the top, and you take the topmost layer of this solution by putting a slide over this and just picking it quickly. So this part is examined under the microscope. But through this method, as I said, some of the helminthic eggs may not be concentrated because they are going to sink down because of their weight, because they are having a higher specific gravity than the saturated salt solution. And as an example, I told you it's an unfertilized egg of Ascaris lumbricoides and some eggs of trematodes. The next thing we can do for microscopy is the permanent staining, which is a recommended method when you are looking for the details inside the cystic structures particularly. So here what we do is we can use either trichrome or iron hematoxylin staining methods. These are the two common methods which are used for permanent staining of stools. These methods are going to give you better contrast, and we examine these specimens under oil immersion lens, that is 100x objective. So this gives us advantage of examining these cyst structures or trophozoite in higher magnification. So at high magnification, along with the contrast given by the stain, we can look for more details inside the nuclei and the presence of some of the structures, and that may be useful in differentiating some closely resembling cysts, which are hard to differentiate many times in the simple saline and iodine mounts. The other example of permanent staining is modified Kinnunes staining, or also known as modified acid fast staining. Now this staining is used for demonstration of oocysts of coccidian parasites such as Cryptosporidium, Cyclospora and Cystoisospora. Here, after the staining, the stained oocyst will look will appear acid fast, and by that I mean they will look pink to red in color. The procedure is quite similar to what we do for mycobacteria, but there we use a higher concentration of acid. But in case of modified Kinnunes staining, it's a cold method where we also use a lower concentration of acid, and the concentration of the staining reagents is also different. So this is the method which we can use for permanent staining of parasites. Besides microscopy, there are other alternatives, including fecal culture for helminths. Now the culture of helminths is different from the culture of bacteria or viruses. In general, helminths are not going to multiply in any of the culture media. It's only a method of concentration. So basically, culture basically is a kind of a misnomer. It's a concentration method by which number of larvae you are seeing in the final preparation is higher. So that is why the sensitivity of diagnosing this infection increases. So what we can use this method in some helminthic infections, particularly Strongyloides tercorales, hookworms. So this not only concentrates, sometimes this also helps us to differentiate the larvae of certain helminths, for example Strongyloides tercorales and hookworm. Because if the larvae of these two or the Trichostrongylus are present in the stool specimen, they are quite similar looking. But then many times you are not able to find them. So that is why concentration becomes important. But when you find them, sometimes it's hard to differentiate. For example, in hookworm eggs. So there are two different hookworms which have their eggs which are very similar, which cannot be differentiated by microscopy. These worms are Ankylostoma duodenale and Nicator americanus. If you want to differentiate whether it's a case of ankylostoma duodenal infection or Nicator americanus infection, you can use one of the methods of fecal cultures, which are not true cultures. But by that, you can basically these eggs are going to hatch during that process, and the larvae are released out, and these larvae are having different features between the ankylostoma as well as in Nicator. So by hatching these eggs in a fecal culture, you get the larvae, and those larvae can be differentiated by specific features. These are some examples of commonly used fecal culture methods for helminths. This is the Harada Mori method. This will be discussed more when we talk about the specific organisms. Basically, it's a filter paper strip with feces applied in the middle, and then you have some distilled, sterile distilled water at the bottom. So what happens is the egg will hatch because the water goes up through capillary action in this filter paper strip, and in the presence of water moisture, if the larvae are present, the larvae are going to migrate towards this water. If the eggs are present, they are going to hatch, and then larvae are going to migrate towards this water. So in the finally, in this sediment, when we take up and prepare a mound of this water from the base, we can look for the larvae. There are other methods like slant culture method, charcoal culture, and then we have Behrmann's technique, which is given here. Just, you can see the picture here. Here you use a funnel with a long pipe here, and you have a sieve in this part. So you put the feces specimen above this sieve, and there is water under this. So the larvae come out through this, and they can be tapped from here because they move into the water part. Similarly, if the eggs are there, they will hatch and larvae will move inside this, and they can be tapped again through this tube. The other method is agar plate culture, where you take a plate of blood agar and you apply the stool specimen. If there are larvae of Strongyloides present in the specimen, they are going to move, and they will create some track marks on the sample, because as they migrate, they will also carry the bacteria from the feces, and these track marks along with the growth of bacteria will show that something has moved here, which will give you serpentine tracks, and then you can see them under microscope by scraping of this material into the slide, and by seeing those larvae, you can again confirm your findings. Besides feces, there are other specimens we may also be useful in diagnosing intestinal parasitic infections. For example, in case of enterobiasis caused by Enterobius vermicularis, the worm itself may be living mainly in the cecum and vermiform appendix, but the eggs are generally deposited in the perianal region. So for this, stool specimen may not be the best option. In these cases, when you take a perianal swab or a cellophane tape preparation, what you do is, for example, this is an NIH swab, National Institute of Health swab, or basically a perianal swab. What you do here is there is a glass rod along with a cellophane tied here with a rubber band, and there is a stopcock here. So when you take a specimen, you just rub this part against the perianal region of the patient, and this is then transported inside this tube. So once it reaches the lab, we basically put this, we take a slide, we take a drop of saline here on the slide, and we put this end on the drop of saline. So when it is in contact with the drop of saline, we just push this rubber band up, this cellophane is released, and this spreads out on the top of that saline drop. So we can put a cover slip over that and examine under the microscope to look for typical eggs of Enterobius vermicularis. Similar is the principle with the cellophane tape preparation or scotch tape preparation, where the tape is applied on the perianal region, it is removed and then applied on a slide, and that again can be examined. So these are some examples of looking for eggs in some specific situations. Similarly, this swab can also be used for collecting the segments of tinea for tapeworms, which may be found sticking on the perianal region. Besides the perianal sampling, we can also use sigmoidoscopy material in certain cases. For example, in intestinal amebiasis, giardiasis, or cryptosporidiosis, this is done only in those situations where a detailed fecal examination has failed, and still we have a high suspicion that there is a parasitic involvement of the intestine. We can also use duodenal drainage material in case of giardiasis, strongyloidiasis, or cryptosporidiosis. This is the anterior test or duodenal capsule technique, which can again be used in certain conditions, for example, giardiasis. In this case, there is a gelatin capsule with coiled thread inside this, and there is one end free. The patient will swallow this gelatin capsule, and the thread will be kept sticking on the cheek with the help of a tape. So after about 30 to 40 minutes, the gelatin capsule is going to dissolve in the stomach and the upper part of intestine, and the thread has reached till the upper part of small intestine. So once some time has passed out, the patient can just pull it out, the thread can be pulled out, and the tip of the lower tip of the thread can be, the material sticking to it can be used to prepare a slide, and you can look for the presence of parasites. So this is known as anterior test or duodenal capsule technique, and useful for some cases of giardiasis infections. Other thing is parasitic infections of blood. It is useful if parasite or any of its development stage circulates in blood. An example include malaria, where you can see the parasite in RBCs, African sleeping sickness and Chagas disease, where the trypanosomiasis are seen in blood plasma, filariasis, particularly lymphatic filariasis, where microfilariae may be seen circulating in blood plasma, and in some cases blood culture and animal inoculation may be useful, but it is not something which is routinely used for diagnostic purposes. The blood specimen, when you send, they should be without any anticoagulant for some of the cases, but in malaria you have to send it an anticoagulant, which is EDTA. In case of blood specimens with no anticoagulant, or from anticoagulated specimens, or for concentrated blood specimens, so there are different indications of each of these. Most of the times you will send whole blood. An examination of whole blood directly or after doing some concentration procedure is usually the method used for many of the blood parasites. Stained smears, which are thin and thick peripheral blood smears, this is a thin peripheral blood smear, this is a thick peripheral blood smear, they can be prepared, and they are considered to be the most useful and recommended methods for looking for blood parasites. You can stain these smears with Romanowski stains such as GMSA, Rides, Fields and Leishmans. These are some of the examples of Romanowski stains. You can stain these smears with these stains and then look for the parasites. Thick smears are mainly used for screening of parasites because they have a higher sensitivity of diagnosis. However, when you want to particularly look into the morphology of the parasite, it's a thin smear which is going to help you in identification and determining the number of parasites present in the blood, which refers to parasite load. So this may be useful in conditions like malaria, where not only diagnosis but also the parasite load may have significance in management of the patient and determining the prognosis of the patient. There are other alternatives to smears, including rapid diagnostic test kits. This is shown here. They are basically lateral flow assays, or they use the principle of immunochromatography. So here we apply the blood sample, and there are two or three bands depending upon the kit. One band basically shows that the sample is right, and if it's a negative, it will show only one band in the control. If it's a positive, it will show, depending upon the number of lines, it may show one or two bands that will reflect the presence of parasite, or also may sometimes help in identifying the species present in the sample. So these are some of the common rapid diagnostic tests which are available for many parasites, particularly malaria. Then you also can use quantitative Buffy coat method. The details will be talked about when we talk about malaria in the future classes. This is again a method in which we use concentration as well as a use of a fluorescent dye, and this is again subjected to microscopy to confirm the finding. You can also use PCR on the blood specimens, and they have the specific indications in specific cases. Now for diagnosis of leishmaniasis, it traditionally depends upon microscopy based methods. In cases of visceral leishmaniasis, specimens which are commonly used include bone marrow aspirate, and in some cases splenic aspirate may be used, although it has higher risk to the patient. So bone marrow aspirate is the preferred sample in case of visceral leishmaniasis. For cutaneous leishmaniasis, skin biopsy specimen is the one which is used for diagnosis. In all these cases, the specimen can be stained with a Romanowski stain such as GMSA or Leishmans, and we can look for the parasite, which are the Leishmania donovani bodies, known as LD bodies in short, and they can be demonstrated inside the bone marrow or splenic aspirate specimens. Now this is an invasive method where you are tapping bone marrow, or you are taking a splenic biopsy. Now in case of leishmaniasis, we have some non-invasive methods available as well, which are not directly demonstrating the parasite, but they are indirect evidence of presence of parasitic infection. Here what we are doing is, it's a test known as RK39 immunochromatographic test, where we demonstrate the presence of anti-leishmania antibodies. So antibodies is something which is the indirect evidence of the infection, and sometimes the antibodies may persist for long even after treatment. So that is why their interpretation again depends upon the patient's background history. And in this case, we are going to use serum because it's a, here we are looking for antibodies. So for when we are looking for antibodies, most of the times it's a serum we are going to use for investigations. Now, cultivation of the parasite may be done in some cases, and molecular techniques are also the options which may be used depending upon the case. Coming to the diagnosis of lymphatic filariasis, you can use the thick and thin blood films which are stained with the Romanowski stain. We can use concentration methods. There are different concentration methods available. We are going to talk about these things when we talk about lymphatic filariasis in detail. Then we can prepare mounds of fresh anticoagulated blood. Now, in case of lymphatic filariasis, we prefer using citrate as the anticoagulant, because in case of citrate, the motility of the parasite and its morphology is better preserved. So you can use a citrated blood, and then you can either prepare direct mounds, or you can prepare mounds after concentration. You can prepare stained thick and thick blood films. You can even perform a QBC assay, which again not only concentrates but also does a fluorescent staining of the parasite. Further, sensitivity of finding these parasites may be improved by collecting the blood specimen between 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. because many of the agents causing lymphatic filariasis in our country have a nocturnal periodicity. So the microfilariae are many times seen most of the time between 10 p.m. and 2 a.m. So blood specimen collected between this time has the best sensitivity of demonstrating the parasite. The other option is that you can give a dose of hetrazone or diethyl carbamazine citrate. Now this drug will stimulate the worm to release the microfilariae into the blood, and these microfilariae can be seen even during the daytime in that case. It's a provocative test where you give the medicine, and after about 30 to 40 minutes when you take a blood sample, you can look for the microfilariae. Besides this microscopic method, which is a direct evidence, we can also use some indirect tests such as RDT kits, which are rapid diagnostic test kits, which look for the antigens of Wuchereria bancrofti, and even some kits which look for the antigens of Brugia malai are available now, but they may be in the form of RDT kits or in the form of the enzyme immunoassays. Microfilariae may also be sometimes demonstrated in other specimens depending upon the case again. For example, they may be seen sometimes in lymph node biopsy and in urine specimen in case of chyluria. Coming to parasitic infections of the urogenital tract, now different approaches may be required depending upon the target parasites. Some of the common parasites which may affect the urogenital tract include Trichomonas vaginalis, Schistosoma haematobium, and microfilariae. So we can prepare a wet mount, which can be either a direct mount or after concentration of the specimen. You can prepare mounds from vaginal or urethral discharges, prostatic secretions, or urinary sediment, and they may be useful for looking for, again, the presence of parasitic elements. For diagnosis of Trichomonas vaginalis infection, PCR assays and other molecular techniques are now becoming more popular. Next comes the parasitic infections of respiratory tract. Now, in the case of parasites involving respiratory tract, the samples which may be used include expectorated sputum, bronchoalveolar lavage fluid, and others. Now, when you want to look for the parasites, you can just prepare a wet mount preparation, and you can try to demonstrate the presence of larvae, for example, in case of Ascaris lumbricoides, Strongyloides trochuralis. Now, to understand why larvae are present in the respiratory tract with the parasite which is actually residing in intestine, we will see when we see the life cycle of this parasite in further classes. So that is why it becomes important to understand the life cycle, because then you know what to expect where. Now, other things could be eggs, for example, in case of Paragonimus westermanni, which is also known as lung fluke. Hooklets and scoliosis, for example, they may be seen in a case of hydrated disease, and the worm is Echinococcus glandulosus. You may see oocysts of Cryptosporidium species. You may see the trophozoites in case of Entamoeba histolytica. Again, an intestinal infection, but extra-intestinal presentations may be there with Entamoeba histolytica. You may be able to find the spores of Microsporidia or cysts of pneumocystis gyrovasai. So all these things may be seen. So for each of these to understand why they are coming to respiratory tract, what is the reason, all those things, you should understand details of life cycle of the parasite. So we will talk about them in individual lectures of these parasites. You can also stain with some stains like GMSA or silver methanamine silver staining. Now this is useful in case of pneumocystis gyrovasai infection. So this is something you should also know of. Now parasitic infections can also happen in other organ systems. So we talked about some common areas where you will find parasites, but then any other organ system may be involved, ranging from muscles to brain to all basically anything. So depending upon the case, again, you may look for the parasitic structures inside the aspirates from different tissues and organs. For example, wet mounts using appropriate staining methods, or pus from amoebic liver abscess, or hydrated fluid cyst. You may also use CSF in some cases to look for the parasites. You can take a biopsy specimen and prepare impression smears or sections. They may be stained, and then again you can look for the evidence of parasitic structures. So all those things are possible. Alternative methods for diagnosis of parasitic infections are also there. So what we talked about were something which are quite commonly used, and they give most of the time give you direct information about the parasite. Now we can also use serological tests, which are again very popular in many infections. They can demonstrate the presence of antigens or antibodies in the clinical specimens. They are particularly useful when the parasites are seldom detected or very difficult to demonstrate directly. So in those cases, the serological tests actually assume a high importance, because you are not able to demonstrate the parasites in all cases, because they are low in numbers and their location may be such that it is tricky to actually pick the parasite from that place. So in those cases, you may use serological assays such as ELISA, IHA, complement fixation test, and others. Similarly, you can use a specific dye test known as Sabin and Feldman dye test for toxoplasmosis. So all these are examples which may be used for making a serological diagnosis of a parasitic infection. You can also make use of intradermal reactions, also known as skin test. Now these tests are not commonly used now, but yes, for historical purposes, yes, the hydrated disease, we can use Cassoni's test. In schistosomiasis, we can use Fairlie's test. So these are again some options which are alternative to routine methods of diagnosis of parasites. Now there are some limitations of antibody based assays. Firstly, the antibodies may not be demonstrable early in the infection. So in the early stages of infection, antibodies are not mounted to a significant level so that they become detectable by our investigations. In endemic areas, because the parasite is high in circulation, there may be a previous exposure of the persons to the parasite, and they may have antibodies already circulating in their blood. So when you test the presence of antibodies, it may not be indicative of a current infection. Also, antibodies may persist for a long time. So if a patient has suffered from some infection and antibodies continue to persist for a few months, so your testing for antibodies may indicate that the patient is infected, but it's otherwise actually the patient has antibodies continuing from a previous infection. And that is why history and other things again become important before you make a final call about the diagnosis. In case of immune suppressed patients, you may also get false antibody based assay results, because antibodies may not be mounted to a significant level and you may get a false negative. You may also use molecular methods such as PCR, real-time PCR, multiplex PCR. Now these have a limited use, but their use is increasing day by day. They have a very high sensitivity, but they are blind tests, and most of the times they just indicate the presence of some genomic material of the parasite. Most of the time they don't reflect upon the viability of the parasite. These techniques may be used when the routine investigations fail to establish a definitive diagnosis. In addition, these techniques may also be used for epidemiological purposes, where you can use for typing, and that will help you in knowing the source of infection and other things. There are some limitations of molecular techniques as well. They require a high level of technical expertise. So not everyone is able to run these methods, because it requires a good level of technical expertise. They need a higher cost, and there is also an increased turnaround time. So as compared to microscopy, which may be done maybe in an hour or so, molecular techniques may require 1 or 2 days or maybe 3 days sometimes, depending upon the case. So that is why the turnaround time is longer, and that is why it may not be useful in all cases of patient management, because patient management may be required on an urgent basis and you cannot wait for 2 days for making a diagnosis in many cases. You can also culture the parasites in some media, including NIH medium, which is National Institute of Health medium, NNN medium, which is Novi, McNeil and Nicole medium, Diamonds medium. So they are some of the examples of artificial culture media where you can cultivate parasites. And most of the time, by culture, I mean these media will be useful for protozoal infections such as Entamoeba histolytica, Giardia lamblia, Acanthamoeba species, Trichomonas vaginalis, Toxoplasma gondii and others. Now, when we talk about cultures, they can be further classified into xenic cultures. Now, xenic cultures are those where you are growing the parasite in association with unknown microbiota. So there is a mixture of different bacteria, and in their presence, you are growing the parasite. Or it be a monogenic, where a single known bacterium is used for cultivating the parasite. For example, in certain free-living amoebae, you use this method. Or you may use azenic media. By azenic, we mean they are artificial media and they do not have any bacteria. So they are basically, again, some chemical substances and other things which have been mixed to prepare this media, and they can again be used for growing certain parasites. Tissue culture is another option where, for example, this may be used in case of free-living amoebae, cryptosporidium species and microsporidia. However, in majority of parasitic infections, the cultures are not much useful for diagnostic purposes. They are primarily used as a tool for research. Xenodiagnosis is another option for laboratory diagnosis, but then again, this is not something which is popular as a laboratory diagnostic technique. It is again more useful in some cases or in case of research. For example, so basically what is xenodiagnosis? It actually involves the use of an arthropod host. So you use an arthropod for growing the parasite. For example, redwood bugs may be used in diagnosis of Chagas disease. Now, redwood bugs are actually the vectors for this Chagas disease causing infection causing parasite, but the redwood bugs may also be used for diagnostic purposes by using them as a tool for culturing the parasite. Besides these evidences of parasites, there are some indirect evidences which are not specific to parasite again, but they may indicate that parasitic infection is possible. For example, there are some cytological changes in blood such as eosinophilia, a raised eosinophil count. And this is more often seen in those infections where there is an invasion of the tissues by a helminth. Anemia may be a presentation, for example, in hookworm infections and malaria. Leukopenia may be a presentation, for example, in visceral leishmaniasis. In fact, in visceral leishmaniasis, many times you will have pancytopenia. Some biochemical changes in the blood may be seen. For example, hypergammaglobulinemia is something which is seen in visceral leishmaniasis and in African trypanosomiasis. Radiological investigations are also very useful in diagnosis. This is particularly true for some parasites, where actually radiological investigations have become one of the most important tools for diagnosis. Some of the methods we can use are ultrasound, x-rays, CT scans, and MRIs, and they may be useful in some infections which create some cystic structures or some mass-occupying lesions inside some organs such as liver or lungs. So in those cases, these investigations may be useful in coming to a conclusion. Thank you very much. I have my lecture already uploaded on the Sarvel platform. You can go through that. If you have any doubts, you can reach me on my email. Thank you very much.